Thank you for joining me today for another episode of Sam's Tech Stuff. Today we're going to be taking a look at my updated Unraid server. The first video that we did, I showed the first version of the Unraid server that I built in a rack mount form. It was using an older case that unfortunately was too wide to actually be rack mounted, and it was using pretty low-end hardware, an embedded Intel Celeron CPU, just one DDR3 DIMM. It was time to upgrade the case also, a rack mountable case, so I could get that off the bottom of the rack. The old one didn't have very good cooling, and it didn't really have any type of cable routing. The new case is one of those Rosewell 4000s. It's a great case. Generally speaking, on sale, probably get it for less than 100. A lot of times it floats between about 100 and 150 though. This is a great rack mounted case for any type of hobbyist or even prosumer type build. It's rack mountable. It's got plenty of fans. It comes factory with three intake fans, which are 120 millimeters. It's got a middle fan tray with three 120 millimeter fans, and it does have two rear, I believe, 60 millimeter fans. So airflow is definitely not going to be an issue in this case, which is a good thing. It does store quite a bit of hard drives. I believe you can get up to 15 officially supported hard drives, 3.5 inch form factor, and it'll support an EATX motherboard, which is amazing considering this only costs about $100 generally speaking. So let's take a look at the hardware in this new version of my Unraid server. You can see I've reused the 3 terabyte drives that I previously had, and I have since added an 8 terabyte hard drive that I got from a external drive that I shucked, which I'll have a video coming up on the channel soon about. You can see that I kept the IBM M1015 RAID card. This is an amazing RAID card. I flashed it to the IT mode to pass the hard drives directly through to the operating system. So this has allowed me to add up to 8 extra SATA hard drives. And as you can tell right now, I only have 5 in the system, so I've got room for 3 more on this RAID card. And based on the motherboard I picked, I have, looks like, 8 more SATA drives. So I should be easily able to max out what this case is capable of. My plan is to actually fill it with hard drives, eventually at some point all 8 terabyte, and then add some SSDs for caching. In this version of the server, I'm using both of my SAS to SATA cables. You can see that I have them routed here to this support underneath the fan tray, and they're all going to all the hard drives that they meet up with. Over in the front part of the case, it is a little bit messy due to the extra slack, so I'll have to clean that up a little bit, but this is what it'll look like. That SAS cable breaks out to all the individual SATA connections. There's 4-to-1 cable, so I've got one cable over here for the 3 terabyte hard drives, and then one cable over here that I plan on using for all the 8 terabyte hard drives that I add to the system. In terms of the motherboard, this time, instead of using one of those integrated Celeron boards, I opted for more of a professional or enterprise series motherboard. I grabbed a Supermicro X11 SSHF motherboard. This motherboard supports the socket 1151 CPUs from Intel, so it's relatively current. It's got a lot of nice features. It has multiple Intel NICs built into it. It's also got an M.2 port if I wanted to add some really fast storage to it in the future. It's quite nice. As I mentioned before, it does have expansion room for up to 8 SATA connections, which will definitely help as I continue to grow the Unraid server. It's kind of tough to see in this shot, but there are 4 DIMM slots in this motherboard, so I should be more than set in terms of memory expansion in the future. For the CPU, I actually recycled the CPU that I was using in the old Milk Crate mining rig that I had on the channel. It's an Intel 3900 series Celeron, I believe. It's a dual core. I don't really need too much more than that for running the Unraid server. I don't actually plan on running any plugins or jails on this. So I just needed something that was power efficient that was able to run the basic operations for the server. In terms of the cooler, I probably could have gotten away with one of the Intel stock coolers, but I did opt for a Gabriel cooler. This is a low profile 120 millimeter fan equipped cooler. In terms of performance, it's completely complete overkill for this CPU, but I wanted to make sure that I never had any type of heat problems, as this is my storage server. And that also reminds me that in terms of the RAM for this server, because it is a storage server, I did opt for ECC RAM. This motherboard does not support registered ECC, so I did use unregistered ECC, but I don't think that's going to be an issue even over the long term. Memory errors are, generally speaking, pretty infrequent, and the standard ECC model RAM should take care of whatever I do run into. Another really nice feature of some of the higher-end motherboards like this Supermicro is that there is a built-in USB port right there, so I actually can have the flash drive that the Unraid operating system lives on plugged into motherboard on the inside. That's nice because I don't have to worry about it clogging up the rear I/O ports, the rear USB port, when I do have to plug in a keyboard or mouse. And during transport, I don't have to worry about the drive getting damaged, falling out, or anything like that. It's nice and tucked away inside the motherboard, and it lives there pretty much forever. Not that it's a huge concern for an Unraid storage drive, but since it is inside of the case, it will be pretty well cooled by the fans. As you can see, for the power supply, I reused my EVGA 650 watt P2 Supernova power supply. The reason I did this is because it is a platinum rated efficiency. The power supply itself actually carries a 10-year warranty, which is absolutely awesome. Definitely the type of quality that you want in a storage server like this. And the massive amperage on the 12-volt rail is really a plus. This power supply is capable of handling up to about 54 amps on the 12-volt rail, and as the number of hard drives begins to expand in the server, that's going to become very important. While hard drives are running, generally speaking, they don't consume very much electricity, but when they do start up, there is an amperage spike. Generally speaking, you probably want to budget 1.5 or 2 amps per hard drive, so you definitely want to make sure that your power supply isn't rated so low that it's going to struggle as the drives start up. Depending on the storage system that you're running, you may have the option to slowly start the hard drives one by one or in groups. This will kind of help take care of that issue, but generally speaking, I would recommend that you buy a power supply that's capable of powering them all on simultaneously without having an issue. An important thing to note, if you're going to build a system like this and use one of these Rosewell cases, the hard drive bays are not accessible from the front. You can actually see that both of these are clips that lock this cage in. It's not going anywhere. And the cage is screwed in from the top as well. So there won't be any hot swapping in order to get the hard drives out in a server like this. That is one of the trade-offs that you make for the extremely low price. So if you can live with powering the server down whenever you have to swap hard drives, this is definitely a great deal on a 4U rack mount server. As for the cable management in the system, there's always a little bit of a struggle. In this server, since I had this middle support here, I decided to Velcro everything together in a bundle right in the middle. While it does look like a mess, it's not that much volume that's taken up in the space. Since I have a pretty low power CPU and a pretty beefy CPU cooler on there, I'm not worried about the CPU overheating or anything. With the second fan tray, there should be more than enough airflow getting pushed through the system. You can probably see here that I am in fact not using a rear I/O shield. A lot of times you'll find people saying that this is a really bad idea since it will impact the way that the airflow moves throughout the case. And generally speaking, that is true. Unfortunately, with this motherboard and this case, when I had the I/O shield installed, the motherboard was essentially getting shorted out and would not boot. So I tried readjusting it a couple of times, but couldn't find that sweet spot, so I decided just to ditch it. In a case like this, with the amount of airflow that I have from the front fans and the middle fan air tray and those rear fans right here, I do not believe airflow is at all going to be an issue, so I figured I'd be fine to leave it out. Just something to note, in general, when you're building computers or even servers that are custom like this with non-enterprise grade products, sometimes you may run into things like this and you just gotta kinda troubleshoot through it and make it work. Right now, you probably noticed that there are not any rails on this, so I can't actually rail mount this in my rack. That is something that I'm working on right now. I just wanted to get the server built, up and running, and tested, which it is. Last parity check I ran came back clean with no errors and everything migrated and installed. So that's great. So the next chance I get, I'll be installing the rail mounts. They go right along this middle line of screw holes across both sides of the server, and then I'll get this rack mounted in the rack. In terms of the older server, you can see the case here and the old embedded motherboard, now two dead fans. I'm not sure what my plans are for the usage of this case going forward, but I definitely plan on taking that motherboard out and that stick of RAM and basically creating a backup Unraid server. So a second physical Unraid server that I store in a different location and then eventually off-site to back up all of my data. It's important to note whether you're running Unraid or FreeNAS or Windows Home Server or really any other solution, even a Synology box, that you definitely need to have a backup. And by backup, I do not mean an array or a second array in a server. You need to have another physical backup, preferably not in the same location, if that data is important to you. So I can't stress enough, definitely something to think about for all of you that do have home servers out there in terms of building a second one to replicate. If you have any questions about the parts that I used in this build or any of the plans that I have for my upcoming backup Unraid server, definitely let me know in the comment section below. You can check the description below the video for links to all the parts that I used in this current build and all the parts that I plan on using in the backup Unraid build. If you're interested in more storage videos like this, server videos, PC builds, or crypto mining builds, definitely consider getting subscribed to the channel. You can click the little bell in the bottom right hand corner to get email updates every time we upload a video to the channel. Thanks for joining us this time. You can follow us on Twitter at Sam's Tech Stuff or on Facebook, facebook.com/Sam's Tech Stuff, or subscribe to the channel.